And there was this frantic pounding on the door, my sister at the door waving the telegram. And I remember going into her house in my nightie, Laura Ashley, circa 1960, red flannel with her, and sitting there with my overcoat on over my red flannel nightie, thinking, I've got into Oxford, and unless I do something really stupid, which I had no plans to do, I'm set for life.
I was nervous, of course, but basically, very excited. This was going to be something wonderful, I thought. And so it turned out.
Beforehand, I thought, I'm weird, I'm not like anyone else. And then when I came here, I discovered there were a lot of other people like me, and that made a big difference.
I applied for St Hilda's because I was the first year of boys, and it seemed just crazy to me that it wouldn't be way oversubscribed, this kind of opportunity to blaze a trail.
I was beside myself. It was one of the best things that ever happened to me. I couldn't believe my luck. I remember throwing cushions in the air in my delight.
My parents were thunderstruck. And they said, how on earth are we going to pay?
It's beautiful and peaceful. Just today, having a wander around Oxford, it's such a homey feeling to cross the bridge and feel like, well, I've done all the touristy bits, now I can go home.
I still believe that Hilda's has, by a mile, the best position of any of the Oxford colleges, even though some others have access to the river and so on. It was a beautiful old country house on the banks of a river, and there was nothing more exquisite in my life before, and very few things since, even though I've been privileged to be in Buckingham Palace and the White House. Hilda's still has that place in my heart as that special beauty.
I think it was December, it was pretty cold and snowy, but had a really fun evening before the interview, sort of meeting some of the students, and then had, I think, two interviews. It's a bit of a blur.
I had two teachers at the time who'd come to Oxford. When they'd first mooted Oxbridge to me, this was how little I knew about the system, and I thought, well, I've got to apply to Cambridge because we've always supported Cambridge in the boat race. So it's, you know. And then one of my teachers said to me, no, look at Dr. So-and-so, who was one of the teachers there at the time. You don't want to turn out like him, do you? And it's like, okay, point taken. And so I started to look at Oxford.
You get some slightly strange subjects. And I remember one of them was, if I woke up in the world, if I woke up in the morning and everything in the world was twice as big, including me, how would I know? And it was, you just don't know how to start on that, so I sort of mentioned a few things. I remember going home and saying to my mother, I think I've just ruined my life. I was talking about giant boiled eggs. And
I was in Hall Building, at the very top of Hall Building, in like a little attic room, and there were four tutors interviewing me around this coffee table, which was about a foot off the ground. So they were asking me to do problems, and I was kind of having to like lean like right over and hunch over.
The interview process, Miss Mann was quite a formidable figure. And she said to me, Canada, bad country for poor people. And I absolutely flared. And I thought, that's it, that's covered my chances. But apparently not.
And there was a train from Paddington, which was pretty much full of everybody going to their Oxford interviews, and everybody had very smart suitcases, and people sitting around me were telling me, you know, they had mothers and fathers who were professors of classics. And I remember feeling pretty outgunned, but I was determined when I got here to absolutely do my best. Had a particularly inappropriate outfit, which at the time I thought was great, which was grey flannel culottes. It's not quite as mad as it sounds, because in the late 70s, that sort of slightly hunting look was slightly in. But I have to say, in retrospect, that probably wasn't a great choice. But I felt very pleased at the time that I'd managed to put this together.
Some of it was terrifying. I remember my politics interview, I spilt the tutor's coffee all over the papers. So she was struggling to read my grades back to me, and I was trying to say, like, no, it doesn't say that. It's better than the coffee stain. All my nerves kind of, I let go because it couldn't get any worse. And it meant I had a lovely interview, and it reminded me why I wanted to study the subject in the first place.
I went to see Mrs. Bennett, who was the principal, and she noticed that I was a Saturday girl in Southend Marks and Spencers. And so, you know, hats off, she'd read the application form. And she said to me there were a particular sort of slipper that she liked from Marks and Spencer, she couldn't seem to get any more. So I said, well, they're probably a seasonal line, Mrs. Bennet, and were you to go in November or December, you might well find them. And I've always thought I got into St Hilda's because I was able to advise the principal on where to get her slippers.
To be perfectly honest, I think back then I didn't realise the sort of the immensity or the gravity of actually getting a place at Oxford. That was just what had happened. You know, I'd sort of like worked through and that was the result. It's only really since I've graduated and sort of like gone through life and realised what a conversation stopper it is.
I loved it from the first second all the way through.
I came up in October, and of course by that time London was having the Blitz. So it was nice to come to Oxford, to get down here and not to have air raids every night, or not to have them at all, actually. I suppose we felt a bit guilty about the fact that we were in Oxford and other people were fighting, although there wasn't all that much fighting going on. Things were a bit difficult, I mean, especially for modern linguists, because you couldn't go to France or Germany, so you couldn't leave the country.
I was very homesick the first term. This can sound a bit pathetic, but this is how it was. I used to go to Oxford, Marks and Spencer's and walk around looking at all the lines, all the different things, which in those days they kept cardigans for years, you know, it was none of this sort of 6 week timelines. And because I knew all the items, it kind of made me feel at home.
There were a lot of readjusting your expectations. I think a lot of us came to Oxford with this experience of being good in school and learning to be average, because average at Oxford is still pretty good. But you have to find out that all of a sudden you're not excelling in all your subjects. I think that was an adjustment in the beginning.
We had to eat in college. We couldn't eat out because college had our ration cards. Because food was rationed. So that was quite simple. We had to eat in college. And St Hilda's food was pretty good during the war. It really was. Better than a lot of colleges, I believe.
The food was pretty awful. I remember one classic meal. It started with a sort of white soup. This was followed by, which was really melted down wallpaper paste, I think, somehow. It was then followed with white fish and a white sauce with mashed potatoes, followed by rice pudding. It was a sort of all-white meal, which is a classic. Gastronomically, it has never been, as far as I can say, equaled.
The food was, I think everyone likes to complain about the food. It's everyone's favorite activity. But I think I have the advantage of having lived in so many places that I think it's more of a shock if you're used to how it's supposed to be at home and then you, for the first time, you're living away from your parents. So in that sense, I think the food was fine. They used to do these really great theme nights in college. I think they only did them the first two terms. I don't know why they stopped, but it was really fun. They would do like Italian night and play Italian opera music and be dressed up and have lots of Italian flags. That was kind of fun.
We'd have this tradition of going to brunch every Saturday. It started at kind of 11. I remember that was a real effort to get up for on a Saturday, getting up for 11.
When you arrived, you really had to learn the vocabulary. It was, and that sort of was a mark of belonging. There were all these different terms familiar terms that meant different things.
Every word means something else. I remember coming here and the first week people were talking about fancy dress and I thought that meant like formal dress. I'm really glad someone told me beforehand or I would have been very overdressed for the first bop. Or just a word like bop, the fact that Oxford has its own dictionary of words.
We had what we called Moabs. They were the little cubby holes dotted around where you could boil a kettle or wash cups and saucers or prepare simple food. And they were called Moabs because in the Bible there is a verse that says, Moab is my wash pot.
One of my rooms I was just thinking about today was about on the top floor above this room. It was terribly cold. And we had coal enough for 3 days. So you went, for we had coal fires. So you went from one person's room to another, whoever had the coal, and we all had illegal electric fires, which periodically blew the fuses.
I lived out in second year, and that was, that would have been an experience, all the student housing, and I remember some of the houses were really moldy and it was just awful. I remember going around to some friend's house and by the end of it, it felt like we shouldn't be cooking there because there was no way that was sanitary anymore.
I had garden room 2 allocated to me when I was in my first year, and I managed to achieve garden room 2 in both my third and my fourth years. I'm very sad, a creature of habit, obviously. My son actually came to St Hilda's for interview last summer, and he was put in garden building, and my husband brought him down, and he said it was like being in a 30-year time warp.
I lived in garden building in my first year, which we were just saying is great because it means that you don't need to look at garden building when you're inside it.
I climbed up the building, yeah. I was only on the first floor, so it wasn't that much of a trek. It wasn't too dangerous. But I mean, if you're going to build a building that is a massive ladder climbing frame, you're kind of asking for trouble.
I had some amazing, amazing tutors. I was actually tutored in both contract and tort law by probably the world's sort of experts in those subjects. And I learnt a hell of a lot that actually stayed with me for the rest of my life. The teaching was so good.
Very entertaining was Hugo Dyson from Merton, who stood there marvellously saying, "The great thing about history is that it gives us elbow room in time," and he flapped his gown. Those are images that stay with you.
My tutor was Miss Crow, who I can genuinely say was the only human being in my whole life who I've been terrified of, totally terrified.
We were warned not to try to go to too many lectures. Just be selective.
I'll never forget my first tutorial where we got our reading list and I asked if it was the reading list for the term, and the tutor said, "No, it's for Tuesday." And yeah, I thought I was going to die of embarrassment. It was only when I walked out, the other students were like, "Oh, thank God you asked that." We were all thinking the same thing.
There were two English dons. One was Miss Rook and the other was Miss Whitelock. And Miss Rook had a dog called James. And on one occasion, Miss Rook delivered her comments on my essay through James. She said, "James doesn't think much of your essay. James finds it really not very serious." I don't know. I think if it had been your much younger, much later times, you all would have been outraged. But I just took it on. "I'm sorry, Miss Rook. I'm sorry, James."
I had one tutor who I think was trying to be incredibly Oxford, and in our first tutorial, she gave us all a glass of sherry, and it was just really weird because she was quite young as well. So it wasn't like you've obviously been here for 60 years and this is how we did it back in the day. And it's just sort of all sat there sort of, and I think she brought Smarties as well or something. So you're there with your Smarties and your sherry, like, okay, shall I answer the question on the board? But what do I do with my sherry? Very weird. And the sort of thing that at the time you're like, oh, it's really weird and strange. And then you go home and you're like, oh yes, we had sherry in our tutorial. And
the first year of PPE, the sort of freshers year, is easily the hardest I think I've ever worked. One of my friends rang me at the end of first year, who was at a different university, and said, "Alex, I'm having this real essay crisis." And I said, "Oh, you know, I know the feeling." And it turns out that what he meant was in 2 weeks' time, he had to produce one 1,000-word essay and no set reading list, whereas I was going to do two of them that night because I wanted to go out the next night.
There was one occasion when I had to go to the lab at about 1 o'clock in the morning. I remember cycling through Oxford and letting myself into the lab all on my own and taking all the measurements, which apparently is not allowed anymore, but back then it was done, yeah.
You always had to go to John Carey's lectures early because the place would be packed out with scientists and mathematicians and all these people who weren't doing English because he was such an entertaining speaker. We were for a short while taught by William Boyd, the novelist, probably in his very early days. And I think he'd just written An Ice Cream War and A Good Man in Africa and something like that. And he's not unattractive now, but then coming to an all-female college, there was a lot of swooning going on. That was obviously a highlight for some of my contemporaries.
I was lucky enough to hear and see the last starring appearance of Tolkien, J.R.R. Tolkien, who had come out of retirement to cover one course of the Anglo-Saxon because somebody else had fallen ill or something. And it is true, he did stride down to the front of the lecture theatre and thump the lectern and shout, "What? Way, yada," and go into the first lines of Beowulf. And he was mesmeric. Because he actually looked like an old Viking, flowing white hair and stern face.
You're not really supposed to say that exams were a really good time, but they were, because that's when you really felt close to everyone and we were all kind of in it together.
And I have a vivid memory of getting into the examination schools and sitting down behind someone who might have been wearing his sub-fast, but he took it off, and I think he had something like it was a bright yellow jumper or something like that underneath. So you had this huge contrast between the formal wear and the kind of, you know, emblazoned yellow that was dazzling me throughout probably the Romantics paper, I think.
So actually I have the old soft cap and a mortarboard, but I never wore the old soft cap except to entertain friends, because one does look like Richard III in it, doesn't one? So in a way it was a sort of feminist statement to wear a mortarboard. Except that it was the thing that women should keep their heads covered in the Sheldonian, rather like in church, whereas men took off their mortarboards. So there we were as the women left bowing in mortarboards, which would then promptly fall off. So that was always a difficulty. Lots of hair clips.
I remember there was quite a lot of discussion amongst the girls about whether or not the soft cap was kind of a symbol of women not having equal status, and some of my friends felt that it definitely was and that we should have the mortarboard. But I also kind of liked looking at old pictures of, you know, the students at St. Hilda's and recognizing the soft cap. I think I wanted that. I wanted it to be something that was particular to Hilda's, and I liked to be able to wear it and not just carry it around like an awkward pencil case.
There was a real rhythm to the year, because we did take part in all the different events. A lot of them were associated with the River Torpids. We used to go on our bikes up to Iffley and cycle along the towpath and cheer on our favourite boat, and then again eights in the summer. May morning was a very big event.
But rowing was good fun. I mean, it wasn't that good fun actually, it was pretty grim, because we had to go rowing something like five mornings a week, because I was in the first eight, which I think it was the crew that got bumped more time in the history of an Oxford bumping race than any other crew ever had been. I can't remember how many bumps it was, but it was, I think, almost considered mathematically impossible, but we managed it.
One of the big things I did was I because I'd been a public speaker and a debater at school, I joined the union, and I stood for office. No, I didn't stand for office. Well, I stood for the committee. I was on the library committee and then on the standing committee.
I auditioned to speak in the union and I was beaten by somebody called Esther Ranson.
When we had a Robbie Burns night party, and so we had arranged from two guys from Christchurch who could play the bagpipes to come to this party and pipe in the haggis, which I had spent hours holding with a fork over a kettle, a filament of a kettle, because we only had two rings in the kitchen, so the other ring was cooking all the potato and all that kind of thing, and I was there with this fork keeping the boiling water, keeping the haggis off for hours and hours and hours, well, it felt like hours. And then I found out the next day that actually the haggis had been pre-cooked, so actually I hadn't needed to do that at all. But it was a great party.
The stewards, who always wore these heavy tweed suits and very sensible leather shoes, I know now they were filling a very important role and they were respected. But if you had a loud party, they'd turn up, bang on the door, and there'd be fines or something awful was going on, you'd be sent down, you know, it was sort of, you know. And anyway, there was a party going on, which was a horror party. So everyone was dressed up as a horror character. And there was this loud knock on the door, which could only be the steward. So this large male undergraduate opened the door and there was the steward looking very fierce, as if she'd just come off, you know, the Scottish Moors grouse shooting. And he was dressed as Frankenstein. He said, "Ladies and gentlemen, may I present my mother," which was fantastic. Apparently got sent down for a term, but everybody thought it was worth it.
I was there from 37 to 41. I had the finals in 1940 as the retreat was taking place from France. And I must say, it was very distressing to see the soldiers, beaten soldiers, walking through Oxford. They were marching along Long Wall and really broken down, very depressing.
We were quite apolitical, which surprised me. And I remember being surprised, thinking, but students in the past have been political. Why are we all so apolitical? And it was not that long after the war. The young men, of course, had done national service, so they were that much older, as far as we were concerned. My best friend was a communist on one side, and the friend on the other side was an ardent Tory. But it didn't impinge very much.
The miners' strike was quite big here. I was here with people from Yorkshire and places like that, who obviously, some were from communities, or had friends and families from communities involved with the strike action. And that went on for a year, the miners' strike, and there used to be posters up around the university because Didcot Power Station was in full flood at the time, if you like, and you'd be invited on these posters to meet at the Carfax at 5:30 in the morning to get the coach to go down and pick it, Didcot. I never went, I was still in bed at that time. But yeah, quite a few people went off to do that.
There was a very, very strong anarchist, anarcho-feminist, feminist movement. There were sit-ins, which got quite rough with the police. There was a strong socialist workers' party, which I don't think were necessarily undergraduates, but they kind of latched on to whatever the movements were. And I remember I was on a Reclaim the Night march, sort of female thing. And I remember there were a group of SWP guys at the back in all their, you know, their boots and their black leather jackets with banners shouting, "Kick out Thatcher, kick out the Tories, strike action now." And I remember thinking, now what's that's got to do with me walking home safely at night? It seemed to me that wasn't a clear link.
There were men's colleges and women's colleges. There were far more men than there were women. For those of us who were here, it worked out really quite well because we were in tremendous demand.
As far as I was concerned, we was one woman for every 7 men. So of course you had a frightfully good time.
I went to a recruiting talk that was given by 2 or 3 young men who worked for the BBC. So I stayed behind with probably 20 other people. And in turn, we spoke to them. And one of the young men I spoke to said, well, we didn't really have women in mind.
You had to have permission to get engaged. I remember sitting in Miss Major's study with my knees knocking, asking, I can still feel the gulp, if I could become engaged, and your beloved had to be waiting outside to present himself, and she would lamp them over and give them... I don't know that she ever refused it, because actually she had no status to do so whatsoever.
The Oxford Union had a debate. I can't remember exactly what the motion was, but it was something like, "This house deplores miniskirts." And the Daily Mirror got wind of this, and this is, of course, of interest to the tabloids. And so they sent up a reporter and photographer to find these Oxford women who were wearing these miniskirts, and they couldn't find them because, a lot of women were wearing trousers, because it's very cold in Oxford, or very thick tights, and not very long, not very short skirts. A photograph duly appeared in the middle of the Daily Mirror, sometime in the autumn of 65, I think that's when it was, And there were about five of us, St Hilda's girls, who, and my bicycle. And really, our skirts were so long.
To come into St Hilda's in 1980 was to come into a college of an immensely proud intellectual tradition. I mean, thinking about what it meant to be at St Hilda's in the 80s in preparation for this, the first thing really that comes to mind is the absolutely formidable women who were teaching here then. And I think it had a tradition of formidable women.
And there was a real pride in still being an all-female college. There really was a real pride in it. And I'm not actually surprised that it was St Hilda's that stuck it out to the end, because there was such a strength of feeling at the time.
The first year we were here, there was a kind of a institutional inertia and institutional memory of Hilda's being all women. And I think the men who came were very, very respectful of that tradition. And the men who weren't respectful very soon became respectful, as the girls in the year above made it very clear how things were going to run and the way things were going to operate. The year below us, I think, maybe didn't quite have the same respect, the same idea that they were treading on hallowed turf as we did. But they more or less took their lead from us. And then I think the year below them just saw it as another Oxford college.
Career highlights. Maybe being a young lady in the middle of nowhere, supervising 6-foot-something drillers built like brick outhouses, and having to stand your ground and say, you need to stop working, your rig's not set up properly, it's not safe. And yeah, there was quite a feeling of power. I've worked on some schemes that most people would know about. So the Pepsi Max big one in Blackpool, I helped design the foundations for that. Valhalla in Blackpool again. Quite a few different fairground rides. So Oblivion at Alton Towers, yeah. So I've worked, it's the bit you never see, it's the bit under the ground that I've worked on. But then that's, in engineering, that's the interesting bit, because that's the bit that you know least about.
And I was the only woman who went into business, and I immediately went into various companies. I went back to I was made the youngest woman director in Britain, and they had the thing in the paper. And I went back to my school, and I was frightfully pleased with myself. And my head teacher said, oh, and I thought you were going to amount to something. That put me down. I was magistrate in the youth courts and the family proceeding courts for 30-odd years, and chairman of 20-odd of those, as well as working full-time, having two children. I was giving at least 2 political dinner parties a week, which I did all the cooking and everything.
I hoped to get into the Wrens. Everybody wanted to get into the Wrens because the uniform was more attractive. After I'd been down for some time, I got a letter from the Ministry of Labour saying, you are still unemployed. If you have not found something by a certain date, you will be drafted into a munitions factory. So I thought, well, I'll give up waiting for the Wrens. So I'll go into the ATS instead, the Army. I was to go into intelligence, didn't say where, but... So then we did this course on, as I say, wireless telegraphy and so on. And then we posted to Bletchley. And that was it. I was there then till the end of the war, because we were reading decoded German messages.
I worked at Canary Wharf for 3 years when Canary Wharf was completely empty. I go to it now and I just cannot believe how amazing it is. But I was there when it was, insolvent. And we turned that round and created lots of new law, actually, around how that was brought out of insolvency, which was intellectually really stimulating and quite groundbreaking at the time.
Once I left St Hilda's, I worked for an accountancy firm for about 6 months, and then I moved to the Bank of England, and I've been there ever since, where I've had an incredibly varied career, from sort of looking at oversight of payment systems to the graduate recruitment manager. I was then involved in Northern Rock in the financial crisis, and until very recently I was the chief cashier, so responsible for everything to do with Bank of England banknotes, including signing them, which was the really fun bit of the job.
I'm a licensed police search advisor. So things like the Queen's Diamond Jubilee, I was responsible for searching the Mansion House before she went there. I was responsible for searching Tower Bridge and St Paul's. And the trouble is, being in the city and doing that on a regular basis, you get a bit blasé and you think, actually, it's not that grand, is it? But then you talk to people about it and you think, yeah, actually, I was, you know, the Queen came and I was responsible for looking after the Queen or for Prince Charles or such like.
I took a master's in health economics at York. And I've been doing that since. I work for a commissioning support unit, one of the new bodies set up in the Health and Social Care Act. And now I'm working in the Royal College of Obstetrics and Gynaecology as a health economist there.
I work as a kind of in-house consultant in municipal government with healthcare, which is totally different from what I studied. But I still feel like I'm using a lot of the skills I developed at Oxford. And I don't know if I found out what I want to be when I grow up yet, but yeah, it's been good.
Best things about Oxford: friendships, the opportunity to discuss ideas, to read what we read, it was beautiful, you know, the architecture, the river. I think Oxford is one of those places which is almost hard to see fresh. It comes filtered through books. I'd read Zuleika Dobson before I went up. The bear that was with me, I called Aloysius after Sebastian Flight's bear in Brighton Revisited. You know, we were all ever so slightly living a romanticised idea of the Oxford experience, I think.
I suppose not in an overweening way, it gave me the confidence to tackle things which perhaps I would have been more hesitant to do, like with the charities, chairing quite large general conferences. Also, to at every opportunity, carrying on studying. And where the opportunity came, not to hesitate to carry on teaching.
Actually, I can still spot people who went to Oxford or Cambridge, and I describe it as people who have essay crisis, and they like leave everything to the last moment, and then they do it because they're under a deadline. And that always reminds me of being back at uni, you know, in terms of that, you know, God, I've got an essay that I've got to get in tomorrow and I'm going to leave it to the night before.
Well, I made some wonderful friends, lifelong friends. And that, well, I met my husband, obviously, too. But and that really, it made such a difference to my life.
Completely changed my personality. I was very shy. I was very introverted. I felt odd coming here. I was able to, I suppose, because I'd be a success and be late to other people, and yes, it completely changed my personality, there's no doubt about that. And that's why I felt always that I owed St Hilda's and have given back. And I hope it continues to flourish, I think it will do. I hope it doesn't totally lose its personality, because it did have a distinctive personality. And if it just becomes just another Oxford College,
I think it's going to be an interesting few years for St Hilda's, because they traded away one very strong identity, being a women's college and being for women's education.
I mean, fast forwarding 20 or 30 years, I'd really hope that all the colleges are still here and there's enough human interaction. There is a real danger that the easier it becomes to use technology, that you don't need to go and meet people. You can have much more sort of virtual universities. But I think, to me, one of the real benefits of university is meeting people and sharing experiences and being able to discuss ideas rather than doing them behind a computer. So in a way, I hope it doesn't change too much.
It's accepting and inclusive, and people stick up for each other and are there for each other. It's a lot of solidarity in St Hilda's.
It's not just somewhere where you study for a few years and then you leave. It's a sort of network and a community that, should you wish to, you can remain part of. And I think that's two-way traffic. You know, you can help the college and the college can help you.
If I think, what does St Hilda's mean to me? I always think of a sort of pragmatic intelligence that is interested in going out and doing things in the world, with a degree of forcefulness, and always with a sense of good humour and high spirits and quite a degree of irony.
I'd just like to say thank you, St Hilda's, for everything you did. I know you'll probably want to disavow any liability for what's been produced, but thank you, St Hilda's, and you know, I hope that St Hilda's will continue for many more hundred years.